مايك از يور باذن الله.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على خير المرسلين محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
My name is Nazih Abdul Hakim. I am the Assistant to the Coordinator for the Carolina Islamic Council, better known as the CIC. This is our third workshop of the year, and we're beginning our second lecture with Sheikh Imam Abdul Nasser Zuhri from the Islamic Center of Marshville, North Carolina. His topic is facing the calamity with faith, facing the calamity with faith. So inshallah, without further ado, may the Sheikh begin his lecture. Assalamu alaikum.
Jazakallah khair. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nastahdihi wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayhi. Na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fahuwa al-muhtadi wa man yudlil falan tajida lahu waliyan murshida. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah wahdahu la sharika lah. Wa ashhadu anna sayyidana Muhammadan 'abduhu wa rasuluh. أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله فأدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح الأمة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اهتدى بهديه إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. الحمد لله. The topic today, as mentioned by Brother Nazih, is facing calamities with faith. And calamities are part of the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his creation. Calamities or masaib or al-bala or al-fitan are from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as mentioned in many verses in the Quran, the life of the human being is filled with struggle and turmoil. In Surah Al-Balad, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي كَبَدْ. We have created mankind, human beings, in a state of turmoil and struggle. And this bala, or these calamities, these masaib, are a way to test us, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test every one of us and reward every one of us according to how they did in this test. At the beginning of Surah Al-Ankabut, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Alif Lam Mim, أحسب الناس أن يتركوا أن يقولوا آمنا وهم لا يفتنون ولقد فتن الذين من قبلهم فليعلمن الله الذين صدقوا وَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ الْكَاذِبِينَ. Alif Lam Mim, do the people think that are going to be left to say, we believe without being tried and tested? Certainly we have tested those before them so that we may know the truthful amongst them and those who are lying. So the tests and the tribulations and trials the calamities that befall human beings in this life are a way of sifting, the way of discerning those who are truthful from those who are mainly making a claim without proof. We have a lot of verses in the Quran that tell us about these ibtila, these tests and these trials. In Surah Al-Mulk, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. It is He who created death and life to test you. Who amongst you is best indeed? In Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَالنَّقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ. And we shall test you with some fear and famine and a lack of provisions and life and crops. Also in Surah Ali Imran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلِيَبْتَلِيَ اللَّهُ مَا فِي صُدُورِكُمْ وَلِيُمَحِّصَ مَا فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. So that Allah test what is in your chest and purify what is in your hearts. There are again many other numerous verses in the Quran that inform us that these calamities, these tests, these trials are from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So once we realize that, once we understand that these trials and tests are from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we are able to deal with them in a more righteous way. We should not be amongst those who complain, those who are not happy with these tests and these calamities. Inna al-masa'iba wal-bala'a imtihanun lil-abd. The calamities and the disasters and the tests, they are a test for the human being. But they are a sign of Allah's love for His servant. هي علامة حب من الله لعبده إذ هو كالدواء فإنه وإن كان مرا إلا أنك تقدمه على مرارته لمن تحب. It is like medicine. Most medicine is bitter, but we have no problem giving medicine to our children or to our loved ones because we love them. We want what's best for them. In the hadith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Inna idham al-bala, inna idham al-jaza ma'a idham al-bala. Wa inna Allah azza wa jal, idha ahabba qawman ibtalahum. Faman radiya falahu al-rida, wa man sakhita falahu al-sakhat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in this hadith narrated by At-Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah, the greatest reward comes with the greatest trial or test. And when Allah loves a people, He will put them to the test. Whoever accepts, is content with the test, then he wins the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whoever is discontent, is not happy, complains about these tests, then he will earn the discontent or the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His hadith is classified as Hassan by Sheikh Al-Albani, rahimahullah. Now, the calamities and the difficulties and the hardships, they are good for the believer because they save him from punishment in the hereafter. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Idha arada Allahu bi'abdin al-khayr, ajjala lahu al-'uqubata fi ad-dunya. Wa idha arada bi'abdihi ash-sharr, amsaka 'anhu bi-dhanbihi hatta yuwafihi bihi yawm al-qiyamah." When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves or wants good for his slave, he hastens to him the punishment for in this world. And when Allah wills ill for his slave, he withholds the punishment for his sins until he comes with all of his sins on the day of resurrection. Again, classified as sahih by Sheikh Al-Albani. So people who go through trials, tests, calamities, tribulations in this dunya, they get the punishment in this dunya. Those who don't, they will get their punishment in the hereafter. Al-Hasan al-Basri, rahimahullah, said, "La takrahu al-balaya al-waqi'a wal-naqamat al-haditha. فلرب أمر تكره فيه نجاتك ولرب أمر تؤثره فيه عطبك أي هلاكك." So Al-Hasan al-Basri said, "Do not resent the calamities that come and the disasters that occur, for perhaps in something that you dislike will be your salvation, and perhaps in something that you like or that you prefer will be your doom." So again, if we understand this, if we realize the meaning of these tests and trials and calamities, then we say Alhamdulillah and not complain and be unhappy about them. Also, Al-Fudayl ibn Sahl قال, "Inna fil ilali la ni'aman la yanbaghi lil 'aqili an yajhalaha, fahiya tumahhisu adh-dhunub wa tu'arridu thawab as-sabr wa iqaz min al-ghaflah wa tadhkir bi ni'matin fi hal as-sihhah wa istid'a'in lit-tawbah wa husnun 'ala as-sadaqah." Al-Fadl ibn Sahl said, "There is a blessing in calamity that the wise man should not ignore. For number one, it erases sins. Number two, it gives one the opportunity to gain the reward of patience. وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. Number three, it dispels negligence. Number four, it reminds one of the blessings during the time of health or when things are going well. And finally, it calls one to repent and encourages one to give charity." So all of these are benefits from the calamities, the trials, the tests, if we understand it properly. Well, also, let's remind the saying of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, حيث قال, "عجباً لأمر المؤمن فإن أمره كله خير وليس ذلك لأحد إلا للمؤمن إن أصابته سراء شكر فكان خيرا له وإن أصابته ضراء صبر فكان خيرا له." رواه الإمام مسلم. Prophet, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "How wonderful is the affair for the believer, for his affairs are all good, and this only applies to the believer. If something good happens to him, he is thankful. He says, Alhamdulillah, and that's good for him. And if something bad or unpleasant happens to him, he bears it with patience, and that is good for him." So whatever happens to us, it is good for us if we take it the right way. وعلى المسلم إذا أصابته مصيبة أن يسترجع ويدعو بما ورد. When something happens to us, then we should say inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. And then we ask and make dua according to what we have been taught by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the ayah that we mentioned before, the end of it, وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ أُولَئِكَ عَلَيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مِّن رَبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ وَأُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ. Give glad tidings to those who are patient. So again, we have to bear these calamities and these trials and tests with patience and having full trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this is for our own good. An Umm Salama radiyallahu anha qalat sami'tu Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yaqul ma min muslimin tusibuhu musibatun fayaqul ma amarahu Allah inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. اللهم أجرني في مصيبتي واخلف لي خيرا منها إلا أخلف الله له خيرا منها. قالت فلما مات أبو سلمة قلت أي المسلمين خير من أبي سلمة؟ أول بيت هاجر إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ثم إني قلتها فأخلف الله لي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. So Umm Salama radiyallahu ta'ala anha, she said, I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, there is no Muslim who is stricken with a calamity and says what Allah has ordered. Verily to Allah we belong and into Him is our return. O Allah, reward me for my affliction and compensate me with something better. But Allah will compensate him with something better. She said, Umm Salama, when Abu Salama died, I said, who among the Muslims is better than Abu Salama? The first household to migrate to join the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then I said it, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compensated me with the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we know that this means that the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, married her after the death of her husband. And so, of course, the Messenger of Allah is better than any other human being, including Abu Salama, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. So there are some things that we need to think about when we are faced with a calamity. And if we do this with faith, then it will be easier for us. And this is from the book Zad al-Mi'ad of Ibn al-Qayyim, rahimahullah. Number one, he said, أن ينظر إلى ما أصيب به فيجد ربه قد أبقى عليه مثله أو أفضل منه وادخر له إن صبر ورضي ما هو أعظم من فوات تلك المصيبة بأضعاف مضاعفة ولو أنه شاء لجعلها أعظم مما هي. So Ibn al-Qayyim said, if he looks at what has befallen him, he will find that what his Lord left with him is similar or better than what was taken from him. And if he accepts it with patience, he has stored up for him something that is many, many times greater than what has lost through this calamity. And if he willed, yani if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed, he could have made that calamity even bigger and even greater. And we will talk about this at the end when we give some examples to illustrate this. Number two, أن يطفي نار مصيبته ببرد التآسي بأهل المصائب ولينظر يمنة فهل يرى إلا محنة ثم لينظر إلى يسرى فهل يرى إلا حسرة وأنه لو فتش العالم لم يرد فيه إلا مبتلا إما بفوات محبوب أو حصول مكروه أو شرور الدنيا أو كظل زائل إن أضحكت قليلا أبكيت كثيرا وإن سرت يوما ساءت دهرا وإن معتت قليلا منعت طويلا ولا ستره بيوم سروره إلا خبأت له يوم شرور. قال ابن مسعود رضي الله عنه: لكل فرحة طرحة وما ملئ بيت فرحا إلا ملئ ترحا. وقال ابن سيرين: ما كان ضحك قط إلا كان من بعده بكاء. The fire of calamity can be extinguished by thinking of those who have been hit even harder. So when something befalls you and you lose something, look and think about those who have lost something even greater, even bigger. Like we are here in the United States and we are facing the calamity. Think about the people in Syria, for example, who not only are they facing the same calamity, but they are bombarded and there is no shopping and there is no freedom and so many things that they are going through. Let them look at his right and he sees nothing but calamity. Let him look at his left and he says nothing but loss. If he were to look at the people around him, he would not see anything but people who are tested, either by missing out on something they like or by having happened to them what they dislike. The pains of this world are like dreams or like a passing shadow. If you laugh a little, you will weep a lot. And if you are happy for a day, you will be miserable for a lifetime. And if you have what you want for a little while, you will be deprived for a long time. There is no day of happiness, but it is followed by a day of pain. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu said, for every moment of joy, there is a moment of sorrow. And no house is filled with joy, but it will be filled with sorrow. And Ibn Sirin said, there is never any laughter, but there comes weeping after it. أن يعلم أن الجزع لا يردها أي المصيبة بل يضاعفها وهو في الحقيقة من تزايد المرض. It should be noted that panicking will not make the calamity go away. In fact, it will make it worse. If you accept the test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is much better than to panic, to complain, or to be unhappy about it. أن يعلم أن فوات ثواب الصبر والتسليم وهو الصلاة والرحمة والهداية التي ضمنها الله على الصبر والاسترجاع أعظم من المصيبة في الحقيقة. Should be noted that missing out on the reward for patience and surrender, which is mercy and guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted as the reward for patience. And this is when we say, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَأُولَيْكَ عَلِيْهِمْ صَلَوَاتٌ مِّ رَبِّهِمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ وَأُولَيْكَ هُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ. If you are patient, then you get three things. Salawat from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, rahmah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, mercy, and hidayah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these are much better than what we think. أن يعلم أن الجزع يشمت عدوه ويسوء صديقه ويغضب ربه ويسر شيطانه ويحبط أجره ويضعف نفسه وإذا صبر واحتسب وأرضى ربه سر صديقه وساء عدوه وحمل عن إخوانه عزائم هو قبل أن يعزوه فهذا هو الثبات الكمال الأعظم لا لطم الخدود ولا شق الجيوب والدعاء بالويل والثبور والسخط على المقدور. It should be noted that panicking makes one enemy rejoice, the shaitan, makes one friend feel sad, it makes Allah angry, and it makes the shaitan happy. It destroys reward and weakens the resolve. If he is patient on the other hand, on the other way, and he seeks the reward, he strives to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this will make his friend happy, will make his enemy sad, seek to relieve his brothers and of their burden and to console them before they console him. This is steadfastness and a sign of perfection. not slapping one's cheeks or tearing one's garment or wishing for death and being discontent with the divine decree. So this is how we face calamity with faith, by being patient, by accepting, not by complaining, rejecting, by screaming, and what some of the al-jahiliyyah used to do. أن يعلم أن ما يعقبه الصبر والاحتساب من اللذة من اللذة والمسرة أضعاف ما كان يحصل له ببقاء ما أصيب به لو بقي عليه ويكفيه من ذلك بيت الحمد الذي يبنى له في الجنة على حمده لربه واسترجاعه فلينظر أي المصيبتين أعظم مصيبة العاجلة أو مصيبة فوات بيت الحمد في الخلد وفي الترمذي مرفوعا يود ناس يوم القيامة أن جلودهم كانت تقرض بالمقاريض في الدنيا لما يرون من ثواب أهل البلاء وقال بعض السلف لولا مصائب الدنيا لوردنا القيامة مفاليس. So it should be noted that what comes after being patient and seeking reward is pleasure and joy that is many times greater than what we could have got from keeping what is lost. Sufficient for him is the house of praise. And this is the house of praise in Jannah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala builds for those who turn to him. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. So let him decide which of the two calamities is greater. A calamity in this dunya by the loss or the trial that he is going through, or the calamity of missing out on the house of alhamd that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises in the eternal paradise. In At-Tirmidhi, it is narrated in a marfu' report, on the day of resurrection, people will wish that their skins had been cut with scissors in this world, when they see the reward of those who were struck with calamity. When they see what happens and the reward that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for those who were stricken with calamity and they were patient and they did the istirja' inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, when they see the kind of reward that they get, they wish that they had been tested like by their skins being cut with scissors. And one of the Salaf Salih said, were it not for the calamities of this world, we would come empty-handed on the day of resurrection. So the calamities, the trials, are a source of happiness on the day of judgment with all the rewards that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for those who deal with calamities, with hardships, with patience, with perseverance, and with thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Ibn al-Qayyim has a lot more to say, but I see we are getting close to the end. So I will mention a couple of examples from the Sahaba and the Tabi'een who show us and illustrate for us how they faced the calamities and the trials and the tests from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first one is Urwa ibn Zubayr, rahimahullah. So he is Urwa ibn Zubayr, ibn al-Awwam. His father is Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, one of the 10 Sahaba being given the glad tidings of Jannah. His mother is Asma bint Abi Bakr Siddiq radiyallahu anha, dhatun nitaqain. So he comes from a very honorable family, and he is a tabi'i. He did not witness the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was in the next generation, a tabi'i. So he was one of the 7 ulama of al-Madina. And during his time, the Khalifa Al-Walid ibn Abdul Malik, he was in Sham, what is now, Syria, for example. And so he asked him, to come to see him. And he had to travel from Medina to Sham. He took with him one of his sons, a beloved son of his. On his journey, before he reached the Khalifa, he was cut in his foot. He had a wound, not from war, but from the way, from the journey. And it kept on getting worse and worse. By the time he reached Al-Khalifa, Al-Walid ibn Abd al-Malik, he was in a lot of pain. So the Khalifa, he called the best doctors of the time. And when they looked at his foot, they said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, we have to cut his foot. He has gangrene and, you know, it is serious. So Al-Khalifa said, he came all the way from Medina to visit me. And now you want me to tell him we have to cut his foot? What kind of reception is this? They said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, if we don't cut his foot, it is going to spread to the rest of his body and it's going to get a lot worse. It's better that we do it now. So he was informed, Urwa ibn Zubayr, rahimahullah, he was informed and he said, do what you have to do. So they told him, the doctors, you know, we have to give you something to, you know, make you go to sleep so that you don't feel the pain. And of course, they suggested alcohol. I said, A'udhu billah. So they said, you know, you have to take something, otherwise the pain is just going to be unbearable. He said, let me go to pray. And when I start my prayer, then you can do whatever you want. And this shows, of course, you know, the khushu' and the istidlal, you know, how, you know, the humbleness that these, you know, people have when they enter the salat. Anyways, he entered the salat, and when he went into sujood, they started cutting. They cut his skin, his muscles, and then they reached the bone, and they brought a saw, and they started cutting the bone, you know, like there was no anesthesia or anything like that. And subhanAllah, he bore it all with, you know, patience, and he didn't scream or yell or anything. So they cut, but the blood would not stop. So they had pour some hot oil on it. And with this, you know, he was so much pain that he lost consciousness. While this is happening, his son, he went to the stables where they keep the horses, and he was playing around, and one of the horses, he hit him with his leg on the head, which killed him on the spot. So Amir al-Mu'mineen, he came to see him after he got a little bit better. And he said, you know, I present you with my condolences concerning the loss of your foot. What did he say? He said, Alhamdulillah, Allah gave me four limbs, two arms, two hands, and two legs or two feet. And he took one of them and he left three. Alhamdulillah. So he took one out of four. I still have more than what he took. And the Amir Mu'mineen said, and I have to tell you condolences concerning your son. He was killed by a horse when you were in surgery. He said, Alhamdulillah, Allah gave me seven children, and he took one of them. He took one and he left me with six, Alhamdulillah. So this is how we face calamities with patience and with faith and with putting our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second example that I will mention and share with you, my brothers, is the example of Umm Sulaym. Umm Sulaym, also known as Ar-Rumaysa, and she is the mother of Anas ibn Malik, radiallahu anhu, the great Sahabi who narrated more than 2,000 hadith. Her husband is Abu Talha. And Abu Talha and Umm Sulaym, they had a boy that was loved very much by his parents and especially his father. And this boy, he became ill. And the father, Abu Talha, he used to go to the masjid and back, but go back and forth. And all the time he would be asking, how is my son doing today? How is my son doing today? So one day he went to the masjid and it was like Salatul Isha. And when he was gone, the son died. So the mother, Umm Sulaym, she prepared the son, she washed him, she put him in the shrouding and, you know, put him to rest in the corner. And then when the father came, Abu Talha, he said, how is my son doing? She said, huwa askanu ma yakun. He is very quiet. Of course, she was not lying, but she was hiding, you know, the truth. She prepared for him dinner. He ate. And then she beautified herself for him. And they had relations that night. And in the morning, before he went to Salat al-Fajr, she asked him, قالت يا أبا طلحة أرأيت لو أن قوما أعادوا أهل بيت عارية فطلبوا عاريتهم ألهم أن يمنعوها؟ If some people lent to their neighbor something like a utensil and then they want it back, can they prevent them from getting it back? قال ليس لهم ذلك إن العارية مؤدات إلى أهلها. They cannot prevent them from getting their utensil back, because when you borrow something you have to return it to its owners. فقالت أم سليم إن الله أعارنا ابننا فلانا فأخذه فاحتسبه عند الله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given us our son so-and-so, and now he took it back. He took him back. So, استرجع. يعني سي لا إله إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. فقال إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. تركتني حتى تلطخت ثم أخبرتني. You left me doing all what we did, and now you're telling me this. فراح إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأخبره بما كان بينهما فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بارك الله لكما في ليلتكما. So he went to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and he complained, or he said to him, he informed him of what happened, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to him or made a dua for him, may Allah bless the night that you had. It is said, ورزقهم الله سبحانه وتعالى تسعة أولاد كلهم حملة علم وحفظة القرآن. So Allah سبحانه وتعالى granted them 9 kids. All of them scholars, all of them memorizers of the Quran. Again, this is an example, an illustration of what happens when we face calamities with patience, with sabr, with acceptance, accepting the test and the trial from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who face calamities with faith, with patience, and with reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه يغفر لكم إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. جزاكم الله خير والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
جزاك الله خير شيخ. I doubt we'll be in a position to take questions unless Sheikh Misbah is able to arrange such. But inshallah, I'd just like to mention that we have the third and final lecture for today at 2 o'clock. And it will be by Imam Mu'ammar from the Islamic Center of Raleigh, and it would be about the
fiqh of calamities.
Fiqh of calamities, inshallah. So that should be kind of a supporting or a complimentary type lecture to this one, inshallah. So inshallah, we hope to see you all back here at 2 o'clock, inshallah.
Inshallah, ta'ala.
Right, unless Sheikh Adli or any other participants have something to say?
Any comments?
Any comments?
Barakallah fika, Mawlana Sheikh Abdul Nasser. I'm waiting, inshallah, on Sheikh Muhammad Adli. He's unmuted now. The mic is yours, Sheikh Adli.
Jazakumullah khairan. I don't know if you hear me or not.
Yes, we do hear you.
To appreciate the talk from Sheikh Abdul Nasser. May Allah reward you. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to be among the patient ones. Yaj'alna min as-sabirin.
Amen.
Grateful to whatever that Allah gives us. And remember, إِذَا أَحَبَّ اللَّهُ قَمَّنْ إِبْتَلَاهُمْ. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves a community, He will test them. May Allah always find us to be firm and strong in our deen.
Ameen, ameen.
To see all of you, inshallah, after Salat al-Zuhr at 2 o'clock for the last final lecture for today. Thank you for your participation, everybody. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaykum salam. Jazakum Allah khayran jamia, inshallah.
Any comments from anyone?
Jazakum Allah khayran. Barakallahu fikum.
Wa fikum al-barakah.
Jazakallah khayr, Sheikh Abdul Nasser.
الله يبارك فيك شيخ حمد.